information technology has powered global innovation. And today, IT is in the midst of radical change as cloud computing transforms the landscape. How can your organization take advantage of the new opportunities? Imagine data centers without boundaries, capacity on demand. Imagine information crossing the globe seamlessly and securely. A modern platform for the world's applications. At Microsoft, we unlock the full range of possibilities. We call it the Cloud OS. And it's here, now.
Welcome. Woo! Yeah! Come on, make some noise! Louder! The developers are next door. Let's give it to them. Come on. Well, let's hope that doesn't set the tone for the rest of the discussion. Welcome, everyone, to TechEd 2012 on the Gold Coast. My name's Macca. For those of you that don't know me, I'm a technical evangelist in the DPE group, Developer and Platform Evangelism. And this is my favorite week of the year. I love this week. This is the week where we all get to catch up with everybody. We get to find out the cool stuff that you're doing on our platform. We get a real buzz out of it. Now, for those of you that are wondering why we're mostly on this side of the room and there's a little bit of empty space there, that's because the developers are all next door doing their plenary session, and we don't really want to have to force them to sit all up the back when they come in. So there will be a lot of people coming in after this particular session ready for the keynote. So just a reminder, don't leave at the end of this because the keynote's got some wonderful stuff. All right, so before we get into this properly, what are you going to expect at TechEd Australia 2012 this year? Well, obviously, we've got our plenary session. This is going to blow your mind. You're going to love this. Coming up after this, we've got the keynote. Awesome stuff to be seen there. And then, of course, you've got the rest of the week. You've got the rest of the week to start learning some new stuff. You've got 10 tracks, 108 sessions, purely for IT pros. You truly can do better than this. Put it into context, there's 155 sessions in the whole conference. You got 108 of them. Fantastic. 150, thank you. 150 speakers nationally and locally. And this all comes out to about 135 hours of session time. And we're not even thinking about the ILLs, we're not even thinking about the exam creams. They're not even included in that count. Now, you can't see all of that, but that's all right. Next week, you can look at it all online and catch up with whatever you missed. Networking opportunities are plenty here this week. Make sure you come down to the Microsoft and Partner Showcase. Talk to us. Tell us what you're doing. And also make sure you go and check out the community and the speaker lounge. A lot of us will be hanging out there. You know, really looking forward to talking with you. And of course, wrapping it all up, don't forget TechEd Hyped on Thursday night. You're going to love that. It's a fantastic party. But you're all bitheads, right? You don't want to hear about this. You want to see some tech. You want to see lots of tech. You want to hear what we've been doing over the last year. And remember, who was here last year? Quick show of hands. Maybe give me a woo if you can manage it. All right, lots of you. And remember last year we were standing here and we were really, really, really hoping to get the guys from the US out to talk about that thing that they were building, something about, what was it, Windows Server 8? And of course we couldn't get them. And we got second best. We got the video. Wouldn't it be good, right? Just once, if we could get him here. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I want to introduce to you the genius, the man behind Hyper-V. Ladies and gentlemen, direct from Redmond, Mr. Jeff Woolsey. Thank you.
Good to see you, mate. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you. Thank you. It's my first time to Australia, and I have to say, I am having a ball. Thank you guys so very much. Gold Coast, Sydney, it's been absolutely spectacular, and I'm already trying to figure out how I can get back here very, very soon. It's been wonderful. It's a tremendous opportunity to be here to talk about the launch of Windows Server 2012, literally the culmination of many years of test and development work. And let me kind of give you a quick overview of what I plan on doing today. So first of all, I just want to spend the first half of this kind of explaining to you what some of the core pillars, tenets, engineering designs, and what we thought about and how we wanted to deliver this release. What changed, what was different, some of the core thinking. The second half, the back half, all demos. Okay? We're going to go into this deep. We're going to talk about demos. We're going to give you demos all sorts of different places. But I want to set the stage before we get into that so you understand exactly what our thinking is. So let's get right into it. Let's talk about some of the key transformational trends that we're seeing in the industry, many of these driving our development. Cloud computing. Quite simply, cloud computing is here, and people are delivering and are building private clouds as quickly as they can. They're looking with an eye to public, whether it's Azure, whether it's service provided, hosted cloud providers, and they're trying to figure out how can we make all of these things work together. There's a data explosion that's happening. We're seeing a tremendous explosion of data. We're seeing 60% year-over-year growth in data worldwide through this next decade. So we're seeing that as a tremendous new change in how we're delivering with all of this data, both relational and non-relational. The consumerization of IT. Quite simply, one of the biggest challenges we heard from you throughout the development of Server 2012 is as an IT pro and as a system administrator, you want to do the right thing. And the right thing actually means you have to walk a very careful tightrope. The right thing is, hey, you know what, my folks internally want to bring in their own devices. They want to use whatever is comfortable to them. They want to be able to take it home and everything just works. And you want to be the guy that helps facilitate that. You want to be the person that makes your business more successful. At the same time, your boss is saying, hey, you know what, this is all really cool and well and good, but at the same time, you cannot reduce the security of our infrastructure. You can't just let people bring in any sort of random device without applying some sort of policy to make sure you're not creating new opportunities for data leakage. So there's tremendous, there's two sides to this, and you're trying to make sure that you can manage both of those. And finally, there's new social and app patterns. People are consuming applications in different ways on different devices. Applications have taken on different roles and responsibilities. There's new application models out there. How does all of these things come together? So when we started with Windows Server 2012, one of the things that was very different about our core development is we sat down with everybody, program management, engineers and developers, and testers. And we basically said, developers and testers, everybody put your pencils down. So if you want to really make a developer and a tester very, very angry, tell them to put their pencils down, okay? And what we told them was quite simple. Guys, if you want to write new test code, if you want to do some prototype work, if you'd like to do some architectural review, some code cleanup, you can go right ahead, but no new features. And what we did was we spent over a year talking with you. Small customers, medium customers, enterprise customers, cloud service providers in all walks of life. Small retailers, huge governments, military, defense, finance, healthcare. We wanted to make sure we understood all of the challenges that everyone's facing. We spent over a year and literally millions of dollars to make sure we understood exactly the challenges that people are facing out there. We wanted to make sure that we took all of those, we put those together, and that was driven by you. So you look at those transformational trends, well, those really influenced how we think about a modern platform for the world's applications. And these are just a few of some of the top-level pillars. This isn't all of them by far, but these are a few of the top-level pillars that we thought about in developing Server 2012. We want to transform the data center. We want to enable modern applications, we want to unlock insights on any data, and we want to empower people-centric IT. At the core, we see that there's a very big change happening with the operating system. Fundamentally and historically, the operating system has been a way to manage resources on a single server. I'm going to manage compute, I'm going to manage memory, I'm going to manage storage, I'm going to manage networking, I'm going to provide an application platform, etc. That has changed. We don't think in single servers. We don't even think in racks anymore. We think in data center units. And because of that, we think in terms of a cloud operating system. It's much more than, hey, guess what? We've got a hypervisor and we've got some management layer to manage a hypervisor. That's a very two-dimensional way of thinking about the world. We think about it much broader and much richer. We also want to be able to enable modern applications. Applications that people are consuming in very different ways. And what I mean by that is we have analytics, social applications, we have modern form factors that are driving new ways for folks to consume applications. And then finally, we want to empower people-centric IT. Yes, people call it consumerization of IT. That's a hardware device-centric point of view. We like to think about it from a people-centric point of view. Whatever device I'm plugging into, however I'm accessing my applications, I want all my stuff to be there. I'll talk about that in more depth in just a second. So when we think about what makes the CloudOS unique, there are three very, very definable parts to it. Number one, we want to provide a very consistent platform that consists of on-premises, that consists of a public cloud, and partner clouds. And they have three very undeniable pieces of importance. When it comes to the partner cloud, it's about reach. When it comes to the public cloud, it's about scale. When it comes to the private cloud, it's about resource pooling. But at the end of the day, what we want to provide is one consistent cloud OS, one consistent platform for all of these things. And I know that everyone has been very, very fixated on how do I deliver my private cloud. In fact, generally, it's not even that. It's even more coarse than that. It's not even private cloud. It's how do I make virtualization work? And we're thinking in much broader and richer terms. And in fact, Server 2012 itself is probably the broadest and deepest release we have ever come out with, going all the way back to Windows NT. So our point of view for the cloud OS is unique, because we do see it as one consistent platform across all clouds, bringing together these capabilities from public, private, and partner clouds. And we are uniquely positioned to do this because of the learnings that we have and our experience running our own data centers. What do I mean by that? Well, at Microsoft, we've been running some of the largest data centers in the world now, not for a couple of years, not even a decade, but for a few decades now. We have over 200 services worldwide. And what this allows us to do is to take those learnings, running at a completely different scale than most people have ever even thought about or considered, and apply those to how we deliver servers and how we deliver the cloud OS to you. Let me give you an example of what I mean by that scale. So we have Office 365, we have Xbox Live, Bing, MSN, Hotmail. We have over 350 million mailboxes just in Hotmail. In the case of Windows Live and Live Messenger, we deliver over 10 billion instant messages a day. When it comes to Xbox Live, we have over 40 million users of Xbox Live. And one of my favorite statistics is during the 1 week of Christmas, during that 1 week through Xbox Live, we'll deliver over 5.5 petabytes of data. So when we talk about cloud scale, we're not talking about a couple of servers, or even a couple thousand servers, or not even tens of thousands of servers. We're talking about hundreds of thousands of servers in multiple data centers around the planet. And we have learned from running these data centers key things that we want to apply to the cloud OS on-premise. It's about operating at high scale across common data centers. So today, thrilled to announce the availability, Windows Server 2012, it's available. And first thing I want to do is I want to give a huge thank you to all of you. Because like I said, we started Server 2012 development with you. We went to all of you and said, what are your biggest pain points? What are the biggest problems? No matter what technology we're talking about. Is it storage? Is it networking? Is it virtualization? Is it identity? Is it file? Is it governance? Is it security? What are those challenges that are keeping you from achieving even greater success? And we want to deliver those in Server 2012. And so far, from what I've seen in pretty much every press release, I think we've done a pretty good job. So with that, let's take a look at what some of our customers have already said about Server 2012. Let's roll the video.
What we're seeing today with Windows Server 2012 is revolutionary. It's not just a couple of little fixes, it's a huge release and it's a huge different experience than what we've had before.
With Server 2012, I think Microsoft has pretty much leveled the field when it comes to the hypervisor with virtualization.
Hyper-V Replica now allows us to move virtual machines through both our private and public cloud locations seamlessly while they're alive. We're seeing very significant performance improvement across the globe.
Our customers can run applications and services and actually achieve more in their business using the power of Windows Server and System Center together.
I don't see any workload known to mankind that cannot be ported to a Microsoft platform at this point.
Windows Server 2012 makes my life easier when I don't have to worry about things after hours. Things I know are running, they're solid.
With Windows Server 2012, we don't need to be concerned in the product development team about our maintenance windows.
Active Directory and Windows Server 2012, together with Hyper-V, virtualizing it, it brought so much more security.
With Windows Server 2012, it's building a great foundation for the future.
So that's just a few things that folks are saying about Server 2012. Now let's dive into some of these key pillars. I'm going to go through these relatively quickly so we can get right to the demos. But first, let's talk about transforming the data center and the changes we've made to core infrastructure. So when we look at the cloud OS and transforming the data center, there's some key elements to this. Number one, it needs to be scalable and elastic. Instead of just deploying a server, we want to be able to deploy a service that can grow, that can be elastic based on your business needs. We want to be able to provide not only just shared resources, but be able to pool those resources and carve them up very finely grained and provide you multi-tenant isolation. Always up, always on. One of the key challenges is, folks, you need resiliency at every level of the stack. One funny anecdote was, I'll never forget when my youngest daughter was about four. She came into the kitchen one day and she said, "Daddy, I want to go to SesameStreet.com. So I typed in SesameStreet.com, clicked OK, and she sits up to the laptop, and I start to turn, and she goes, "Daddy, it's broken." I said, "What?" And I turned back around, and it had taken an extra couple seconds for SesameStreet.com to load up. But it was very clear. My daughter doesn't expect any downtime ever. This is the world she lives in. It's got to be instant. It's got to be always on. This is what folks expect across all walks of life. They expect it in all of their applications, wherever they are, whatever device they are on, and they expect to be able to get their data. And if there's hardware failure, if there's network failure, if there's storage failure, they expect that the infrastructure itself is going to be resilient, if not self-healing. Automated and self-service. So one key thing I want to point out to everyone in this room, if you want a long career in IT, you want a long career as a system administrator, I've got one big word for you. PowerShell. The way that we're used to doing servers, hey, let me go TS into the box. Let me remote into that server. That's been nice in the past. That's not how you're going to be successful at cloud scale. You're not going to go to a single server. You're not going to do this at one at a time. What you really want to do is, you know what, I'm going to go to that pool of servers, to that racks of servers, or to that data center, and I'm going to apply a policy, but I'm going to do it via PowerShell. I'm not going to log into any machines. I'm going to do all of this remotely and remove human error. I want to be able to repeat it consistently without any issues. PowerShell is the key to doing that. With over 2,400 new PowerShell commandlets in the box, this is a great opportunity for you to advance your skill set and make sure that you have this on your resume if you really want to have a long career in IT. So with Server 2012, quite simply, when it comes to enterprise class scale and performance, there is no one that tops Windows Server 2012. And that includes the announcements made last week by our friends over at VMworld. Okay? With Server 2012, we support quite simply the largest servers, the largest virtual machines, and the largest clusters by far. We support up to 320 logical processors per server. To give you an idea how big a machine that is, that's 16 sockets. Each socket has 10 cores, and then you enable symmetric multithreading. In addition, we support up to 4 terabytes of memory per server. We support virtual machines with up to 64 virtual processors per VM. And let me point out, that's true in both Windows Server 2012 Standard and Data Center Edition. I don't need to go out and buy Enterprise Super Special Plus Edition at $3,500 per proc to get that feature. We include it in all editions. In addition, we support the largest storage by far. with support for up to 64 terabytes per virtual disk. That's 32 times anyone else in the industry. And let me point out, that's per disk, because I've had a number of people say, is that per VM? No. We support up to 255 virtual disks per VM, and each one of those can be up to 64 terabytes. So I did the math, and it's roughly about 16 petabytes of storage per VM if you really need it. But you're going to run out of physical storage long before you run out of virtual storage. When it comes to clusters, we just announced with the RTM of Windows Server 2012, we now support up to 64 nodes, and get this, 8,000 virtual machines in a single cluster. Why did we do this? We did this because you asked for it. Our largest enterprise customers, our cloud service providers, our hosting partners said, we really want to create these large scale out clusters. And the reason why 64 nodes is important, if you want to do 8,000 VMs, by the way, on 8 nodes, you can do it. That's 1,000 VMs per server. We support it. But you really want to get better dispersion than that, which is why we support up to 64 nodes. So you get the best of all worlds. So we have huge performance and scale. And in terms of virtual machines, we've demonstrated, I've demonstrated this publicly on numerous occasions now, we can deliver easily over 1 million IOPS from a single virtual machine. Because of that, we can virtualize over 99% of the world's SQL server. Full stop. Over 99% of the world's SQL server. And the reason why we did this was because, again, what did you tell us? You told us you want to virtualize everything. You told us you don't want to leave any stone unturned. In fact, we've actually been virtualizing with Hyper-V for many, many years and been extremely successful. If you've ever been to msdn.microsoft.com, technet.microsoft.com, or even microsoft.com, this has been powered by Hyper-V for over 4 years without any downtime. We did that with both Windows Server 2008 Hyper-V, 2008 R2 Hyper-V, and now we are redefining performance and scale with Server 2012 Hyper-V. Virtualization across compute, storage, and networking. We look at virtualization very broadly. It's not just about compute. It's not just about memory. For us, we looked at storage and networking. For Server 2012 now includes storage virtualization. You can create it, take a whole bunch of JBOTs, direct attached storage. You can now pool those together with storage spaces and then carve those up and get mirroring, get parity. Then you couple that with a new Windows Server 2012 file server and you get shared storage as well. So we've got some powerful new storage capabilities in the box. And let me take a brief moment to mention the file server. The Windows Server 2012 file server, if there's any one complaint I have, is that I wish we would have renamed it. Anything else. We could have called it Fire-Breathing Dragon, and I would have been really happy. Because the thing I want you to understand is the Windows Server 2012 file server is nothing like any file server we've ever shipped before. Take everything you know about Windows Server file server, 2008 R2, and just throw it out the window. This is not your grandfather's file server. We've demonstrated performance of copying 16 gigabytes, not bits, 16 gigabytes per second to the new Windows Server file server. That's over 4 DVDs per second to a file server now running Server 2012. We also include thin provisioning, deduplication, and a whole bunch of new capabilities that you may be used to seeing in higher priced storage arrays now in our file server. And by the way, if you own a storage array, anybody here own a SAN? Anybody? Guess what? Server 2012 is a no-brainer if you own a SAN. We spent a huge amount of time making sure that, quite simply, Server 2012 takes full advantage of the capabilities in your storage array. So whether you've made an investment in file-based storage or whether you made an investment in block-based storage, Server 2012 is the answer for you. When it comes to block-based storage, we now understand thin provisioning, trim, and unmap, so that when a server is communicating with your storage array, in the past, we just let the storage array do whatever it wanted, but we were blind to what was happening. Now server actually understands and is communicating and understands what's happening on the storage backend. In addition, we've introduced a whole bunch of new capabilities like offloaded data transfer, which leverage the capabilities of the storage array to dramatically improve performance and scale and do it in a secure fashion. And folks, I am just barely scratching the surface of what's new here in Server 2012. Finally, continuous availability with management efficiency. Again, this goes back to one of your favorite topics, virtual machine mobility. In Server 2012, we took VM mobility to the absolute ultimate. We went after the holy grail itself, which is the ability to live migrate a virtual machine from one system to another with nothing but an Ethernet cable. No shared storage, no SANs, no file servers. It's called shared nothing live migration, and it's simply in the box. In fact, I have to give credit to one of my colleagues, Ben Armstrong, who I know is here as well, and he's a native Australian. He showed me something that blew my mind once. Okay, we do demos all the time, and we're always trying to best each other. And I've shown shared nothing live migration over an Ethernet cable. But he came to my office one day and said, I got to show you something even better than that. He's like, here's my tablet and here's my laptop. And he live migrated VMs over wireless. Pretty awesome. So shared nothing live migration is a key mobility feature that's simply built into Server 2012. One last thing I want to talk about availability is our new cluster aware updating. So one of the things we want to do is we want to make it really easy for you to patch your underlying servers, whether it's the operating system or whether it's the hardware itself, with automated cluster updating. So now I can simply set up a schedule. Hey, the last Friday of every month, 9 p.m., this thing will automatically go through every node in the cluster. It will live migrate the VMs off to other nodes. It will patch it, it'll reboot it, and then it'll evacuate, and it'll bring the VMs back on over. And it'll literally go through every node in the cluster, and you can just sit back and watch it all happen. If you want, there's a great big, go do this right now, go update the cluster right now, and you can sit back and watch it. This type of automation is simply built in the box. And that feature, again, came directly from you. You said, I want to be able to manage my clusters completely hands-off. Got it. Done. In the box. So next, let's let's go on to quickly the next customer video, and let's get to our next topic.
Availability is critical to us. We deal in very large scale databases and data repositories. Some of the specific reasons that Windows Server 2012 was very exciting to us was in the area of file server capabilities.
With Windows 2012, I don't have to worry about file storage. It just works.
Where we're able to transparently take down a single node of the cluster, have our applications automatically move over to other nodes, then we have plenty of time to work on the node we just took out of the cluster, do our patching, do any type of hardware maintenance that we need, bring it back online, and then let Windows Server 2012 rebalance the loads. It's not just a couple of little fixes, it's a huge release, and it's a huge different experience than what we've had before. I would call it revolutionary.
What we see now is really an embracing of technology by students.
The student body coming in, they're really technically savvy.
Our infrastructure is growing all the time.
Network infrastructure for the university has changed dramatically with this increase in laptops and these mobile devices.
Windows Server 2012 is going to help us a lot, transform the way we do some of our outages. With our Server 2012 Hyper-V environment, we have a lot more comfort in patching Windows systems than we do with VMware-based hosts.
Now you can set at a cluster level to say, I want to patch this entire cluster, and you walk away and it does all that work for you.
With Server 2012, I think Microsoft has pretty much leveled the field when it comes to hypervisor with virtualization.
We're able to easily move our VMs from VMware over to Hyper-V now.
With Hyper-V on 2012, it's right there, and then when you couple that with System Center 2012, you get this entire package that, for us, it's a no-brainer.
OutSource3 are a cloud service provider. We are based in the UK, but we have a global reach. Over the last 2 years, we focused on being a pure play cloud provider.
The way that we position ourselves in the market is we've got a very high quality enterprise grade platform for business critical applications and workloads.
Our customers can run applications and services and actually achieve more in their business using the power of Windows Server and System Center together.
Currently, in order to isolate our customers, we have to provision VLANs and subnet. With the network virtualization feature, we basically have the ability now to run multiple customers on the same hardware with the same IP ranges.
Customers these days really want flexibility, especially when they're looking at kind of hybrid model of cloud. They want to be able to move things, migrate things from on-premise to a hosting provider like us to Azure.
Windows Server 2012 brings us a huge amount of new technology, new features, new capabilities.
So Windows Server 2012 is about more than just infrastructure. So we've taken a look at how we were going to transform the data center, but now let's move up a little bit and talk about enabling modern applications. One of the questions I get asked all the time from folks who come visit in Redmond and want to chat is, where are we going to be in 10 or 20 years? Are we still going to be delivering, everybody going to be running on private cloud? Is it going to be public cloud? The answer is yes. It's going to be all of the above. What we generally see right now is everyone's working on their private clouds, but they also have an eye to the public cloud, and they're realizing, I can take advantage of some great scale, some rapid deployment, and not have to deal with a huge capital investment in hardware. In fact, I can start deploying on Windows Azure, taking advantage of its scale and the ability to deploy very quickly and provide resource usage based on consumption. So let's talk about the modern application. So what we think about the cloud OS and we think about modern apps, we think about cloud scale. Quite simply, one of the biggest challenges today to developing any new application, whether it's internally or if it's a public-facing application, is just how much hardware do I need? Just how much storage do I need? What's my networking look like? Well, with a cloud scale application, the goal here is let's go ahead and deploy it, and as you need more, it's scalable and elastic and will grow as it needs it. It needs to be flexible and easy. We want to be able to provide modern runtimes as well as flexibility so that you can run what you need to be able to do and be successful wherever that is running. It needs to be hybrid and extensible. Again, you need to be able to run parts of it maybe on-premise, some of it in a service provider, some of it on Azure, but we want to give you the flexibility and extensibility to do all of those things based on your business needs. And then there's the rapid dynamic lifecycle, which is you want to be able to provide a service model that's easily extensible and easily serviceable. And so to that end, Server 2012 provides the flexibility to build these on-premises and in the cloud. For example, Visual Studio and the .NET framework. Okay, we're providing the best capabilities, the best development platform. .NET framework allows me to deploy whether I'm running on-premise, whether it's running a service provider, or whether I'm running on Azure. We've also made some huge investments in the .NET framework itself. .NET 4.5 has some fantastic performance and scale improvements. But we also understand that the world doesn't revolve around .NET as well. We have great support for Java. You want to run PHP, you want to run Node.js. These simply just work. Just simply work. When it comes to open web and development applications and a scalable and elastic infrastructure, we've done some huge work around IIS 8 to make sure that IIS 8 is the most scalable web server out there. I'll give you a few examples. Number one, IIS 8 is now completely NUMA aware. So if you're running IIS 8 on Big Iron, or if you're running it on Windows Server 2012 Hyper-V, where we're projecting a NUMA topology within the virtual machine, IIS 8 now knows how to make compute and thread resource allocations with optimal locality for physical hardware. So this means you get the absolute best in performance and best in scale. We also provide CPU throttling now in IIS 8. This is something that our cloud service providers asked for us very specifically. They said, I want to be able to provide CPU throttling so in a multi-tenant environment, I've got multiple organizations, I want to make sure that one of them isn't taking too many cycles from another. I want to be able to provide quality of service to meet that service level agreement. Also, we have centralized SSL support, centralized SSL certificate support, which enables you to run an entire server's farm's worth of applications based on a centralized store of SSL certificates. That's just a few of the things that we've done in IIS 8. And I should also mention, when it comes to the cloud OS and enabling modern apps, of course, one thing is about networking itself. And I didn't mention this, so I'm going to mention this now in terms of the core infrastructure, which is network virtualization, or software-defined networking. One of the things I've heard over the last 6 to 10 months is all of a sudden everyone's talking about software-defined networking like it's brand new or something. We've known about this because this is how we deliver data centers. This is how we run Azure. This is how we run Hotmail. This is how we run these data centers. It's also a huge pain point for our hosting providers or enterprises. Let me give you two examples. Some of our cloud service providers, the way they provide services for new customers is every new customer gets a VLAN. Okay, that's an interesting one. So all of a sudden you've got 50 customers, you've got 50 VLANs. You've got hundreds of customers, you have hundreds of VLANs. That management becomes a nightmare. The other thing to point out is the VLAN specification specifically says we'll support up to 4,095 VLANs. But it turns out there's a whole bunch of physical switches out there that actually don't meet the spec, and we've run into hosters that have actually hit the switch limit, the limits in their switch, because they only went up to about 1,000. And so they actually had to quickly take out a whole bunch of switches, make a huge capital investment, upgrade their switches to get the full 4,095. But now they're looking at that 4,095 limit going, how do I solve that? Well, we knew about that. We spent a lot of time figuring out how to solve that problem, which was with network virtualization, another key capability to enable both changing the way we improve the infrastructure as well as a way to enable modern apps to provide that seamless hybrid approach. So with that, let me switch on over to another customer video about how customers are being successful with our new modern apps.
Rackspace is a specialist in web hosting and cloud computing, and we manage IT infrastructure for companies of all sizes, startups to enterprises, and everybody in between. Customers look to Rackspace to give them a variety of solutions, a portfolio of capabilities. Customers want choice and flexibility and the ability to move workloads wherever they make sense, whenever they make sense. Windows Server 2012 is a key element in making sure that that platform continues to evolve. For big enterprises, they lean on Rackspace to manage a lot of their web infrastructure, big customer-facing websites, big e-commerce applications. We're really excited about the work that Microsoft's done to make sure managing large configurations in a multi-tenant environment in IIS 8 is really easy. We need to make sure that we can scale, that the configurations are easy to manage, that they can really offload some of the burden of our management teams, our sysadmins, really to the system itself. With IIS 8, we have a whole bunch of new capabilities, but one that I'm really particularly excited about is this CPU throttling capability. It gives us the ability to provide isolation around customer deployments, web servers that maybe are in a multi-tenant environment. One of the key concerns is having one customer impact another one from a performance standpoint. You don't want that. Windows Server 2012 is building a great foundation for the future.
So next, let's get to unlocking insights on any data. And it really comes back to the fact that we're dealing with any data, any size, anywhere. We want to be able to connect with the world's data, which is growing at an exponential rate. And we want to be able to provide these immersive data experiences. So how are we doing that? Well, number one, it's about providing a complete data platform from Excel to SQL to Hadoop. We want to make sure that let's take the most used application for sorting through and using BI, Excel, and using this as a way to bring together both your structured and unstructured data. Integrated data reaching beyond your organization, and analysis and insights with familiar tools. It's about taking some of these really, really huge amounts of data and mining it in ways that are new and interesting, and tapping into this growing data volumes of big data to ask new questions and to gain new insights. Bring those insights into your business and allow you to provide differentiated opportunities and solutions for your customers. Finally, let's get to people-centric IT. I want to be mindful of time here because I want to make sure we get right to the demos here. So, as I mentioned before, a lot of people tend to think of this as the consumerization of IT. We like to think of it as people-centric IT, which is the person is first. And we want to make sure that wherever I am, on whatever device I have that personalized experience on any device, anywhere, whether it's my phone, whether it's my laptop, whether it's my desktop, whether it's a tablet, wherever I may be, whether it's the back of a taxi or actually sitting in my office or at home on my couch, I expect to be able to get to all of my data wherever it may be. But at the same time, we all together have this key challenge of how do we make sure that we're doing this in a secure way, that we're not necessarily opening up ports and opening up ways and access to all of this data, but at the same time, providing new opportunities for data leakage in my infrastructure. It's got to be secure, and it's got to be well managed. To that end, Active Directory at its core. We use Active Directory as our solution for managing identity profiles, and now we've taken Active Directory into the cloud with Windows Azure AD. And with Windows Azure AD, you can determine what you want to synchronize with Azure AD. It's flexible according to your policy, so you can decide what makes sense for you. When it comes to dynamic access control, this is really interesting. One of the things that we found in our extensive research for planning for Server 2012 was we spoke with a number of security analysts who go in and help you actually audit your infrastructure. One of the biggest challenges we found out were file servers. People tend to set up file servers, put all sorts of very important data on it, forget that it's up there. Oh, and then by the way, they have contractors or people who are, you know, coming through the business in a transient sort of way who happen to have access and all of a sudden get access to all sorts of data that they maybe shouldn't have access to. With dynamic access control, we're providing policy and governance to help you provide policy to help protect your data on these file servers. So for example, I could put an Excel spreadsheet on a file server, and it could. What happens is the file server will look at the data itself. If it finds tax ID information, social security card information, PCI data, it can automatically encrypt the data. So this is a way to help you, system administrators, help you keep your job and help you keep your business tightly secured so that data isn't walking out the side door. And then finally, a comprehensive VDI solution with simplified deployment. This is huge. We've now extended VDI in a huge amount of ways with RemoteFX. RemoteFX, we used to call this Remote Desktop Protocol or RDP. We now use RemoteFX for the protocol is because it's such a huge change in this release. Up until now, RDP has always been about using it on a LAN. With RemoteFX and Server 2012, we can now provide a great solution on the WAN as well. And that's really just the tip of the iceberg. And literally, I could keep going, but I don't want to do that. I want to get right to the demos. So to do that, I'd like to invite Michael Leeworthy up here, and let's take a look at Windows Server 2012. Michael?
Awesome. All right, how you all doing? So I'm sorry I don't have the American accent, but I do want to talk to you about Windows Server 2012, because as Jeff was saying, you can really see how it's the cornerstone of our cloud OS. And I want to take the persona of an IT administrator in a company called Contoso. And you know what? At Contoso, we're always striving to create agile infrastructure to support, you know, applications, modernize our end user experience. And applications are really important to us. And there's one finance application that I know, as we go through the end of the year, requires a lot more capacity. Really, I need to dynamically scale my infrastructure to support that. And that's a worry. Plus, I'm not always in the office. I've got lots of remote sites, and I'm always traveling to these remote sites. So sometimes it's hard for me to actually get into my data center and reconfigure my data center. First, I want to introduce my little device here. Now, I'm sure you've seen Windows 8, but this is great. You know, I can do all my, you know, all my little consumer stuff. I can read books to my kids. I can tweet. I can do that type of stuff. But I can access any corporate environment from this device. Let me show you an example of that. Alrighty, so here's my personal environment. Now, when I think about capacity, we have capacity documents in our organization. And one of the things is, though, as Jeff was saying, is that my security officers want to make sure that this information is kept securely in my information in my organization. Now, I might have a device, no matter what device that is, and I want to ensure a security policy on that, so this capacity document doesn't leak to my competitors, doesn't leak out into the world, you know, the world. I don't leave it on a USB stick on a plane somewhere. And Windows Server 2012 Remote App is the perfect solution for this. For one, it integrates into my environment seamlessly. And two, it allows me to keep all that important data on my centralized network. So you can see here are all the applications that are available for my remote app. Now, yes, I can run Excel locally, but what happens if I'm on an RT device? What happens if I'm on any Windows 8 device? This gives me seamless, consistent experience into that environment. So I'm just going to open up Excel here and connect via a remote app, and then go and have a look at some of this capacity document in my environment. Apparently, I'm in. Let's go try that again. Great, so as Excel is open, you can see it fits seamlessly into my desktop environment. It looks and feels like I'm running it locally. Now I'm just going to go run my capacity document. And while we've also got this centralized security, I'm also running another level of security on top of here called Dynamic Access Control. And Jeff mentioned this briefly. This not only provides a just heap of ease of management for my IT administrators around claims-based authentication, the ability for me to get away from ACLs for Jeff and for John and for Ben, but also provides me that automatic encryption or classification of documents. Don't rely on your users to classify and encrypt their documents. You know, let the system and the server do that. So you can see here that this information has been defined as high business impact automatically by the system and automatically encrypted to ensure that level of security. So it can't leave this folder, it can't leave this data center. So looking at this Excel sheet, I know that my capacity is quite low. I really need to think about Windows Server 2012. I really need to think about how I can start using some of that inbuilt agility to immediately create capacity for my current application. But also, I want to start thinking about the cloud. How can I take advantage of the investments I've got with service providers and with Azure to create that data center without boundaries? And how do I do this seamlessly? So let me actually go back and open my corporate desktop. As I said before, it doesn't matter what Windows device I am on, I can access my corporate desktop from anywhere, whether I'm in the back of a taxi, whether I'm at an airport, or whether I'm sitting at my desk. I have full access to this environment through the power of Windows Server 2012 VDI and the remote desktop services. So I just want to take a step out here, and having Jeff here is really great. This whole concept of virtualization is huge in 2012. I mean, you asked us to virtualize the unvirtualizable. Workloads that require tens of cores, hundreds of gigs of memory, likely SAN attached, high I/O. And we did that with Windows Server 2012. And I want to show you some examples of how I could use that today to increase the capacity on the fly. So one of them is virtual CPUs. All right, so I've got a virtual machine here, and I ported this across over from R2. So currently I have four virtual processors on that. I can instantly up that into 8 virtual processors by just doubling my amount of my virtual processors. And as Jeff said, up to 64 virtual processors if I have those logical processors available in the box. I've also got the ability to do relative weight on that as well, to really be able to sort of hone in on some of the dynamic access that I have within this virtual machine. But virtual CPUs are just one part of my capacity. What about things I can do on the fly without any downtime, any interruption to my experience? So I've got another virtual machine here that's running my database tier. You can see here that it's currently utilizing up to 4 gigabytes of memory through dynamic memory. On the fly, I can change this to 16 gigabytes of memory. Without any downtime, without any end user interruption, I've now got 16 gigabytes of memory available to that. Also, I can define memory weight as associated with this as well to ensure that this application, this database, has access to the memory on this virtualized host and on this Hyper-V host. But memory is just one part of it. What about accessing that database? Great, I can increase the CPU and I increase the memory. I want to be able to ease my access to that. And now we have inbuilt bandwidth management into Hyper-V. Now you can see me doing this with the GUI, and in fact, it takes me longer in the GUI to do it than it takes with PowerShell. It's a simple command with PowerShell. And if I can do this in PowerShell, I can automate it, I can orchestrate it, I can base it on times of the day based on a schedule. You know what? I want to give this minimum bandwidth. I want to have this application have 512 megabits of network bandwidth available to it during business hours. I can write that up. I can schedule it. I can orchestrate it. So it's a very, very powerful solution in this environment. And as I said, I can completely do this on the fly. But that's really just one side of the coin. What about storage? As Jeff said, we've made some incredible enhancements in storage. I mean, again, our customers asked us to really create highly resilient, highly reliable, and performant storage on industry hardware. And I want to show you how you can use that dynamic capacity, a dynamic capability to increase your capacity on the fly. Before I do that, I just want to quickly show you something here. What you can see here is my database is not attached to a C drive or to a D drive or to a direct attached storage. It's actually attached to an SMB share. So my database files are sitting on a file share. In fact, I can put my VHD files also on a file share. The great thing about this is because I can use these application file shares for my applications, such as Hyper-V and SQL, I get great resiliency, incredible performance, and I get huge amounts of flexibility in the way that I can deploy a data center. I can start thinking away from servers and away from data centers and think about services, storage services, networking services. So let me show you some of the actual storage platform that this is running on. And Jeff mentioned this before around a technology we call storage spaces. Now, with storage spaces, we're virtualizing the storage layer, abstracting the direct connection of a disk to the actual physical disk as well. So the concept of virtual disks. And I can create these virtual disks based on the needs of the application that it's actually supporting. So you can see here I've got a Hyper-V VHD disk, I've got an application disk, and a SQL disk as well. And these are effectively an amalgamation of physical disks in a storage pool, which I've built this virtual disk infrastructure on top of it. And because I've got this, I can hone and shape it, I can create mirroring, resiliency, parity, I can grow and shrink it as needed. In fact, you can see here I'm running out of space. Quick glance view, red is bad. You know, if this was a physical-based environment, I'd have to move data off, or I might have to take a system offline to rebuild an array or something. With storage spaces, I simply right-click, I'm going to add a virtual disk, choose an available disk. In fact, I can actually set this disk up as a hot spare in case I have a spindle failure or something in a disk, it will automatically come online. Click OK, and instantly I have disk space available. No downtime, no end-user application interruption whatsoever in my storage environment. So on the fly, I've basically, you know, increased my storage capability with 2012. I've adjusted my memory capability. I've created a bandwidth profile and to ensure quality of service for that application. And I've also provided, you know, some of my virtual machines greater access to the virtual CPUs in their environment. So I've done some really great capacity planning with my data center, but I really want to now start thinking about my application tier. And I want to create the most agile application tier for my, of course, my applications, but also for my developers and end users. However, you can see that we're running out of capacity, even with 2012. I want to start thinking how I can create this most agile infrastructure, and my service provider is a great solution for this. But one of the challenges I've always had is that when I put workloads in my service provider, one, I have to take that workload offline to transport that, and two, I'm subject to their IP infrastructure, so I have to put VLANs in and subnets, and I have to do all this stuff between these two systems to be able to move these workloads across. Now, with Windows Server 2012, we introduced these two great technologies, network virtualization and live migration, in fact, shared nothing live migration, to overcome this scenario. So let me show you just a really quick example of something here. What you're seeing here is a tool that is showing two IP addresses for a VM. It's showing what we call a customer address. So this is the IP address of that system. If you did an IP config, if you did a ping, you know, this is the effective IP address that you see. So in all intents and purposes, this is the IP address of my VM, of my server, or whatever it is. And underneath that, there's a provider address. This is the IP address, the physical IP address, the physical representation of that IP address. We've abstracted the IP layer away from the physical layer. Now, if I can do that, then I can virtualize my IP allocations. I can virtualize my network. If I can virtualize my network, I can cross subnets, geographical boundaries. In fact, I can actually jump companies and extend my IP address across a completely different company that may have a completely different subnet, a completely different IP allocation. That's what network virtualization allows me to do. Incredible flexibility by abstracting my virtual networking away from the physical layer. So as I said here, we have our provider address. Now these two are the same, the provider addresses, because we're using a technology called GRI, generic routing encapsulation. So each of my Hyper-V hosts has a single IP address for all the VMs on that. And through the magic of network virtualization, we can all communicate, they know where the VMs are, and they can get the packets to the right systems. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my application environment, and I'm going to migrate across over to my service provider. So you can see here's that Windows, here's that application VM. I'm simply going to grab it. You can see here I have my servers sitting up in my hosting environment. I'm simply going to grab it, drag and drop to my hosting environment. Now, first thing I'm going to do is going to communicate with the hosting environment and say, hey, do you have enough capacity to support me? Yes, you do. Got enough logical processors, all that type of stuff. And then I'm going to hit migrate VM. And through the power of live migration, I'm now moving why that VM is running from one subnet to another, from one company to another, from one physical network to another, without any downtime, without any end-user interruption, utilizing nothing but an Ethernet cable. And in fact, we should see this in real time. We should actually see this virtual machine move from my Contoso Corp over to my Fabricam hoster while keeping its IP address and changing its provider address. So we should be getting really close to the end of that now. Now, the other things that we're doing with live migration, as Jeff said, is really increasing the scope of our live migration. The ability to really provide live migration for any type of resource, any type of a virtual machine resource you have in your organization. So the last thing I want to think about is my web tier. How do I now access my web tier? How do I ensure my web tier can be easily accessed, can be easily made available? My web tier is my hard one. It scales, it grows, it shrinks, it contracts. And Windows Azure is the perfect solution for this. And in fact, what we've done within Windows Server 2012 and System Center 2012 and Azure is created a simple, seamless tool to be able to, for you to manage all your clouds in one view. So you're seeing here is my private clouds, my application cloud, and of course my Azure cloud. And if I want to deploy a new virtual machine into any of these clouds, it's as simple as hitting the deploy button. First question it's going to ask me is, what cloud do you want to deploy this into? I've automatically chosen Azure. I'm going to select a deployment type, so it's going to ask me for an Azure deployment type. It could be anything, an image, a disk, some sort of resource. I'm going to choose an image here, and the best application platform that we have, Windows Server 2012, of course. I'm going to click OK. Now it's going to ask me, where do you want that deployed? What service do you want me to deploy that into? So I'm going to choose a cloud service here that I've pre-configured for my finance application. Now, as soon as I click OK, you'll see that I already have this cloud service pre-built with a number of virtual machines. So I can simply just add a new virtual machine to that. I click the configure button. I give this virtual machine a name. I choose its instance size, like T-shirt, extra small to extra large based on my need. So I can choose small. I'm going to choose a disk. What VHD do you want me to connect it to? Where's the container that this VHD is going to live in? I've pre-configured a finance container for this demonstration. And then I simply put a password in. Now, the thing here is I can actually put a lot of other things as well in to ensure that I can configure that. But I want to make sure that I'm up and running as fast as possible. So I can just hit now the deploy button, sit back, relax, and I know that virtual machine is deploying to Azure. So you say, that's great. How do I manage that? That's not part of my domain. Do I have to go out to Azure tools and stuff? Now, Jeff mentioned server manager, multi-server management inbuilt in the box. I can take my server manager tool that you saw before. All I have to do is add that server into my server manager, click OK. Now, it's not part of my environment, not part of my domain, so I'm just going to have to authenticate to that. So I just quickly come down here, click manage as. Put some credentials in. And as simple as that, I'm now managing all my virtual machines, no matter where they are, Azure, service providers, or on-site within my server manager. Now, if I can bring it into server manager, then I can manage it as any one of my VMs, or any one of my Windows servers in my environment. I can then utilize PowerShell, and I can utilize other features as well. So you really saw how we've taken the ability to provide end-user support and modernize the end-user experience, how we built applications that can be deployed across any cloud, and how we can provide always on and always up dynamic capability for all those workloads on Windows Server 2012 available right now. I mean, Windows Server 2012 is really the cornerstone of our cloud OS. Thank you very much.
Excellent, Michael. Awesome. Think about what you just saw there. He just had the ability, he just created on the fly, he had the ability to, first thing was asked was, where do you want to deploy your new services? Could have done it on premises, through a service provider, and he just did it live, real code, with Azure. I was just talking with a customer before I got on the plane to come out here to Australia, and I was talking with him about what we think about the cloud OS and the ability to be able to do exactly that. And he said, you know, I get that. That's awesome. That's Star Trek, though. You can't do that now. That's 20 years from now. That's 10 years from now. I said, no. That's exactly what we're delivering in this release. That's exactly how we think about the cloud OS. It's all there right now. Whether you're a large company and you want to deploy with System Center, you can do that. Or if you're a small company, you just saw we created and managed with Server Manager and the box using the in-the-box tools. So we want to provide solutions for companies of all sizes. I'm not kidding when we say this is one of the largest, broadest, and deepest releases we've ever come out with. So with that, just want to point out the industry's ready. The time is now. We've been talking with customers and partners. We have hardware vendors right now that have servers certified for Server 2012, and we have fast track configurations. If you'd like a pre-configured private cloud, question I get asked all the time is, Jeff, I just want to deploy 500 VMs. How do I do that? Well, I could give you a whole bunch of ways to do the capacity planning, or you could call one of your hardware partners that probably has a fast track that's ready to go that says, if you want to run 500 VMs, here's the server storage and networking. Here you go. Here's the package. We've had these for years. Fast track solutions are out there, so take a look at those. System integrators are thousands of are trained to deploy, and if you haven't done your certification for Microsoft Private Cloud, there's no better time than now. Service providers right now are looking at Server 2012 and loving what they see, because we have done more for service providers in this release, I would say, than in any release of server, with things like Hyper-V replica, that gives you the ability to replicate virtual machines. A service provider can now quickly and easily be a VM replication disaster recovery site. And finally, we have a huge pipeline of application vendors and software vendors to support Server 2012. In short, we want to make sure that we provide the definitive cloud OS that you asked for. Thank you very, very much, and enjoy your time here at TechEd Australia.
Okay, so just before we start getting ready for the keynote, everyone please stay in your seats because the keynote will be happening here, so there's no need to move. You probably all noticed a bit of swag. You've got a bit of swag as you came in, your Windows Server t-shirts. I'm particularly happy at the moment because I'm the only one in the room with this particular design. If you're interested in collecting the different designs we have, well, a betting man would say maybe head over to the Windows Server photo booth back in the showcase, get your photo taken, tweet about your experience in there, and that might be a good way to maybe get one of these particular designs as well. Speaking of the showcase, make sure you get out there, check that out, and of course, check out the demos we've got, and also the 82-inch Perceptive Pixel screen whiteboard that we're using out there. It's pretty damn cool. In terms of Twitter, make sure that you're sharing your Windows Server love on #WinServe and #AUTechEd, and we also have a surprise for you, which I'm not going to tell you about now. So stay here, don't move. You're going to find out all about it in the keynote. Thanks very much.